Thank you. Thank you for taking your time for my session, Machine Intelligence at Google Scale. I'm Kazu Sato. I'm a developer advocate at Google. It's like an evangelist for Google technology. I'm focusing on products for data products, big data solutions, and machine learning products. I'm working at Tokyo office and visiting Seoul right now. So today, I'd like to cover these topics. At first, I'd like to introduce what is neural network and what is how deep learning works with the live demonstration. And then I will discuss how Google has been using deep learning technology to implement our services. The latter part of the session will be talking about how we are trying to externalize the power of machine learning to outside developers with the products such as TensorFlow or Cloud Machine Learning, Cloud ML. So what is neural networks? How many people have used neural network? How many people has played with neural network? Not so many, a little bit, maybe a few people. So maybe for the most of you, this will be the first times where you're watching the live neural network working with my demonstration. Neural network is just like a function in mathematics or programming language. So it can take an input data and it outputs the data. So for example, if you want to neural network to recognize an image of a cat, you can take a cat image as an input and convert it into a large vector. And then neural networks do many calculations inside it. And then you will have another large vector as an output that has a label such as cat or human face or car or anything. So it's one use case of the neural network. But thing is that neural network can be trained, can learn from the training data set. And you can apply the technology to any kind of application you want. For example, if you're operating your game server, you can try using game neural networks to find premium users or the cheating player in on your game application by converting your server logs from game servers into a vector and try to learn from the training data set. Or if you are running some advertisement business, you can try using neural networks to predict how much click rate you would get for certain users and ads creatives. So neural network is a function that can learn from the training data set. Let's take a look at how neural networks actually works with this very simple data set. This is a data set called Double Spiral. It has two inputs. One is x0 and another is x1. And if you plot dots based on the inputs, you can see there's a double spiral pattern on the data set. And if you are a human, it's really easy to predict whether each data point should be in an orange group or blue groups. For example, if you have a new data point here, you can speculate that it should be in an orange group. But if you have, but if you want to do the same thing by using computer programming, what kind of program you would write? If you're a programmer, you want to write many if statements with many conditions and thresholds to check the location of each dot, whether it should be in orange or blue. I don't want to write that kind of tedious program code. So instead, I would use neural network. This is a demonstration called Playground, where anybody can play with your own neural network design. This is actually JavaScript-based neural network implementation. And you can specify number of the neurons and specify how many hidden layers you want to use to solve each problem. So let's start learning the neural network training. Now I have started the training of the neural network. You can see that right now the computer is not great at predicting whether the point is in an orange group or blue group. But eventually, by taking many training data, a computer can learn that how to predict whether each data point should be in orange or blue. And you can see here, this is the error rate or training loss rate. It is decreasing right now. So by spending much computing power and providing much training data, you can have a computer learn how to classify each data set to satisfy your requirement. Now it finished the training. The computer is now trained to classify the data sets into two groups, orange and blue. And if you take a look at what each neuron is doing here, it's very interesting that each neuron is doing very simple things. For example, this particular neuron only classifies whether the dot is in an upper layer or a lower layer. This neuron only classifies whether the data point is in a left or right. So it's very simple. It's a very simple linear classification. But having more and more hidden layers to build a hierarchy of the recognition patterns so that the neurons at the higher layers could be much smarter. These neurons can recognize a little bit complex pattern like this or like this. And this neuron has much more complex patterns hidden inside data set. And there's a final neuron here, there's a single neuron here that decides whether the data point is in an orange group or blue group that gets smart enough to recognize the very complex double spiral pattern. And you can replace this double spiral pattern with your own data set. If you have a game server or ad server or any kind of server, you can try using neural networks to solve your problem so that computer tries to learn from the training data set to solve your problem. So having more hidden layers and having more neurons, you can make the neural networks much smarter so that it can extract what kind of features to solve a particular problem. By extending these technologies, you can even have computer classifying what is this. Your computer now can understand this image as a cat. This image should be an image of the British short hair. And if you take a look at those real deep neural networks, it's interesting that the neurons closer to the input data will be trained to recognize very simple patterns such as edges, vertical edges, or horizontal edges. But if you take a look at the neurons at the middle layer or higher layers, you can see the neurons could be getting much smarter and smarter, like recognizing a texture or part of an object, or a whole object like a car or a ship or a cat or a human face. But for this kind of the high quality image classification, you have to have over like a 40 or sometimes over 100 hidden layers to build the hierarchy of the recognition patterns. So this is the basics about the neural networks. Let's talk about how Google has been using these technologies to provide our own services. Most of the people in this session are using Google's deep learning technology every day because we have been using deep learning for deciding the ranking of Google's search result. It is called RankBrain. It's a deep neural network-based ranking algorithm. And that has been the best improvement we had in the last 2 years in Google search service. Google Photos is a very popular application for smartphones. You can take photographs with your smartphones, and you don't have to put any tags or metadata on it. The deep learning technologies behind Google Photos can understand what's the contents of the image, like a dog or cat or your friends, or is it your friend's wedding photos, kind of thing. Gmail has a smart reply feature that can read the context of the email exchanges between users so that the smart reply function can show a pop-up of the options of the replies. And you can just select one of these options to write a reply. So now it generates over 10% of the all responses on CentOS mobile. That means now the email has been exchanged between computers, not by humans. That's very interesting. Now Google Translate is using neural network-based machine translation technique. So it uses a neural network technology called recurrent neural network to understand the time series data generated from the natural languages. It provides much higher quality than the traditional approach. This is another very interesting use case inside Google. The DeepMind team, the team who built the AlphaGo AI, they have designed a new deep neural network to control the cooling energy system in our data centers. And that AI was able to save up to 40% of the energy consumption. And that means we can save up to 50% of the total power usage effectiveness, or PUE, of each data center. This is so huge for Google because we are spending so much money for the power consumption in our data centers. Again, this is done by the deep neural network technology. So now at Google, we have over 60 production projects that is using deep learning. Not only the traditional machine learning, but also the deep learning technology. And now we have started to externalize this power of machine learning or deep learning technology to outside developers. We have two kinds of products. One is the green diagram. It is called machine learning APIs. It's a very easy to use API. So anybody who doesn't have any machine learning knowledge or experience, just send your image or audio or text to the API, so you'll be getting the result in a few seconds. The other products are designed for data scientists or developers who have machine learning knowledge. We provide the frameworks or platforms for those people. So let's start looking at the ML APIs. The first product is Cloud Vision API. That is an image analysis that provides the image analysis pre-trained model. So you don't have to train your own neural network by yourself. We already trained the model, and we provide the API to access that. It has the REST API, so you can just send your image to the API, and you'll be getting the result in a few seconds. So let me show some demonstration. This is a demonstration called Cloud Vision Explorer, where we have imported over 80,000 images into the cloud storage and applied the Vision API already. And Vision API gives back the labels for each image, such as cat or mountain or human face. And based on those labels, we have done the clustering analysis, means you're building a cluster of these images and mapped into the 3D space. And you can walk around inside the 3D space where you have the clusters for vehicle images or the residential area images or painting images or night images. So if you zooming into the vehicle cluster, each dot in the cluster represents the single image. And you'll be seeing some thumbnails popping up like this. Looks like it's a cluster for airplane. So if you click any one of these, for example, if you send this particular image to the API will be returning labels such as airplane or vehicle, or this must be a Boeing 737. The API thinks this must be a Boeing 747 because it has the four engines, I suppose. If you go to the animal cluster, there are clusters for dogs and cats. Here we have the cat I showed. The API thinks this is a photograph of a cat, but it's not just a cat. It must be a cat as a pet. I don't know how the API, you know, thinks it's a pet. Maybe looking at the background, it's a room. And all API can also detect that it's a British short hair, not just a cat. If your picture has many faces, then you can detect the location of each face, like the eyes and nose and mouth. And also you can even detect the emotion of each face. Is it smiling, or is it in anger, or surprising? So for example, if you have a service counter for your customer, then you could have a web camera on the counter and take a picture every second to send the image to the API, so that you can easily count how many faces in a day for the service counter and how many smiles in a day for the service counter. So you can easily measure the customer satisfaction rate by using the API and the web camera. This is also another interesting use cases where you can detect the very popular landmark. It's called landmark detection. The API thinks this must be Citi Field Stadium in New York City, and it can also reply with the longitude and latitude, the coordinate. We can do this because we have so many images gathered from worldwide, like a service with the services like a Google Street View. We have so many images that can be used for training our deep learning model to predict the location of each image. The second API is called Speech API. It's a pre-trained model. So again, you don't have to learn anything about this voice recognition. You can just send your audio data to the API, and the API can return the recognized voice in a text. And you can support over 80 languages, including Japanese and Korean. And it's now public beta, so you can start trying out right now. Let me show some demonstration. So I'm not sure if it works well because I have an English accent issue, but I can try. Let me try. So it's Tech Planet, so, okay. Hello, this is a demonstration of Google's machine learning technologies. I'm visiting Korea right now to demonstrating at Tech Planet. Not exactly. What's at Tech Planet? Maybe, but it's still a high quality and real time. You know, you can get the result in under 0.5 seconds. It's so fast. Also, we have another API called Natural Language API, where you can put any kind of natural languages. Unfortunately, it only supports English, Japanese, and Spanish right now. But if you put the English here, here's the. As you can see, it can analyze what are the entities, means the name of the product or name of the location inside the natural language, like a Google or Mountain View or Android must be in some entities with locations. And also with English, you can do the sentiment analysis. That means you can determine whether the sentence is talking about anything positive or negative. So you can, for example, if you collect any sentences from the social media, like a Twitter or Facebook, and do the sentiment analysis, and find your product name as an entity, and count for analyzing what people are talking about your product. And also, you can do the syntactic analytics like this. You can determine what is the part of speech for each word like this. And also, you can determine the dependency between each word. So all of these are all based on the deep learning technologies we have been using Google, and you don't have to learn anything about it. You can just send your data, text, audio, and images to the API, and you'll get the result. But those API cannot cover all the applications. For example, I'm getting so many inquiries from hospitals or medical institutes to for finding a cancer in medical images such as CT or MRI. Or some other customers are trying to use deep learning technologies for finding bad products on their factory, manufacturing plant. For those applications, I recommend them to use TensorFlow, which is an open source library for machine intelligence. TensorFlow is an open source library, especially for building a deep learning model. But also it can support the other machine learning algorithms. We have launched the product last November, and this is the latest machine learning framework we are using inside Google. So many machine learning developers and researchers in Google are actually using TensorFlow. And we are sharing the same technologies with outside people. And now TensorFlow is the most popular framework for machine learning and deep learning in the industry. The reason why TensorFlow was able to get such a popularity, because it's very easy to use. A few years ago, it's really hard to getting started with deep learning technology. But with TensorFlow, you can just write a single line of Python code like this to define your neural network. For example, if you put the cat image here, and if you want a label of a cat or human face, then you can write just a single line of code like this, where you can put the cat image here, and you'll be getting your label here. And as I show on the initial demonstration, the computer can learn, can train the model, such as parameters such as weights and biases, by using the optimization algorithms. And until a few years ago, it has been the hardest part to implement the training part, I mean the optimization algorithms by yourself, like a gradient descent or AdGrad or ADAM. But by using the TensorFlow, you don't have to understand the most difficult part or sophisticated part of those training algorithms. You can just specify one line, what kind of the algorithms you want to use for training your model. So even if you don't have any experience on machine learning or deep learning, you can easily getting started with the technologies by downloading the TensorFlow code. And also another advantage of TensorFlow is portability and scalability. You can start trying out the technologies with your own Mac, and we'll be soon releasing Windows version 2. And you can for the easiest example, like recognizing handwritten numbers, you can just use your own Mac. But soon you will find that it's too slow to use your Mac to train a much bigger model. For example, if you want to classify the cat images, you have to train your model with tens of thousands of images. And you would need to by your own GPU server, which is 10 times or maybe 40 times faster than CPU. But still, you have to spend a few days, or even some people are spending a few weeks to finish their training of neural network model. So now people are starting to use the tens or maybe hundreds of GPUs on Google, on cloud. But still, you can keep using TensorFlow, and you don't have to change a major part of the of your neural network design. So that's the scalability of TensorFlow. And also, once you have finished your training of your neural network, you can copy the model to the mobile devices or IoT devices such as Android, iOS, or Raspberry Pi. And even if your mobile device or IoT device doesn't have any internet connection or cloud connection, it can do the prediction by itself. For example, if you have a factory where you have the IoT sensors and getting data, you could put a Raspberry Pi running TensorFlow on it to do an image classification or maybe time series data analytics with Raspberry Pi. And everything can be done with TensorFlow, so it's so portable. So this is the power of TensorFlow, and by having this power of TensorFlow, many people have started using the technologies And actually, many non-machine learning experts, many beginners have started to learn how deep learning works to solve their own problems. I call it as a democratization of deep learning. For example, there's a cucumber farmer in Japan, and they have a son. Actually, this son has been working as an embedded system designer for a long time. And for the last 1 year, he has been helping their parents' cucumber farm. And he has downloaded TensorFlow sample code to implement their own cucumber sorter by using deep learning technology. Let's take a look at the actual demonstration. So this is the cucumber sorter built by the cucumber farmer. When he put the cucumber on it, it runs TensorFlow on it with Raspberry Pi, and it can classify the cucumber into 9 different classes. Until now, they have to spend 8 hours a day to classify all the cucumbers by human hand. And you have to take a look at the shape or color or thickness of each cucumber to classify those cucumbers into 9 different classes. But he was able to get the 70% accuracy by using the sample code of TensorFlow downloaded from the website. And he's so sure that he can increase the accuracy up to 95% or more by spending much more computation time. He's not an expert of machine learning or the deep learning. He's just a beginner and is getting started with deep learning a few months ago. This is again another very funny use cases. It's a fried chicken nugget server powered by TensorFlow. So this is a use case by the company called RT in Japan. They are not focusing on machine learning. They are a company for robotics arms. They are specialized in robotics arms. And they had an intern student. He was interested in using TensorFlow, and the company let him playing with TensorFlow a few weeks, and then he got this after 2 weeks. Again, the company is not specialized for the machine learning nor deep learning, but they were able to get this in 2 weeks. The TensorFlow model was able to recognize where's the chicken nugget, locate it, and let the robotics arm picking it up. This is another interesting use case for TensorFlow for sorting garbages. The garbage can has a camera and a Raspberry Pi on it. And if you put any garbage on it, like a paper or bananas, the TensorFlow model can classify whether it should be a compost or recyclable. If you put banana, maybe it should not be a recyclable, so it should be a compost. This is a professional use case of TensorFlow by the Aerosense. Aerosense is a company in Japan, subsidiary of Sony. They are focusing on providing the drone-based solutions. They fly drones on the construction site to do the inventory tracking of the materials like the steels or trucks and cars. And they were able to use TensorFlow to count how many cars and trucks in the field. So as you have seen, in the last 6 months, by using TensorFlow, many people have started using the technologies to solve their own problems. But if you want to bring those ideas and technologies into production, the largest challenge you will be facing is the computing power. That's the largest disadvantage of neural networks. Neural network requires training, and that takes so much computing power. As I mentioned, by using the powerful GPU servers, it takes a few days or a few weeks to finish your training. So that's the reason why we have started using Google Cloud to implement so-called distributed training. Each data center in the Google Cloud worldwide has tens of thousands of machines equipped with GPU processors. And the largest difference between our Google Cloud and the other cloud is the network. We have been building our own network hardware by hiring many hardware designers from scratch. So we are not using the very popular network equipment such as Cisco or Juniper. Instead, we have been designing and building our own network hardware to have the very high-speed interconnect between the servers. The Jupyter network working in our data center right now can support 100,000 of 10 gigabit Ethernet port that can yield 1.2 petabit per second as a total data center bandwidth. And we have been using these network technologies for solving many problems such as big data operation or deep learning distributed training. And TensorFlow, one advantage of using TensorFlow is scalability. By defining your own neural network design with TensorFlow, you can run your training on tens or hundreds of CPUs or GPU without changing any major part of your graph. And to build the distributed cluster for that kind of training is not an easy task. You have to think about the scheduling between CPUs and GPUs. You have to think about the communication such as RPC or RDMA. And you have to think about the quantization, meaning a compression of the parameters or models inside your neural network design. But as long as you are using TensorFlow, you don't have to think about those complex things. The runtime for TensorFlow running on cloud can take care of those complex tasks. And also, now we have announced a new technology called TPU, or Tensor Processing Unit. This is not a CPU, or this is not a GPU. It's a specialized LSI, or ASIC, designed just for TensorFlow. And it supports the bit quantization techniques at hardware level, and that can yield 10 times better performance per watt ratio than running the prediction of your neural networks on CPU and GPU. So the end result is the cost effectiveness. You can get the power of neural networks much cheaper. What's the end result of running TensorFlow on Google Cloud? So end result is the much, much shorter training time. For example, if you want to train your neural network model for image recognition, you can get 40 times faster training time by running 50 different GPUs at the same time. For RankBrain, the ranking algorithms used for Google search, we are able to get 300 times faster training time with 500 nodes. So, as I mentioned, right now, most of the developers for the deep neural networks spending a few days or a few weeks to finish their trainings. That's the hardest part of using the technologies. But for Google engineers, you can just finish your training within a lunchtime, like 30 minutes or 40 minutes. And if it fails, you can try with the other configuration. So that's the largest difference between Google and the other companies. And that's the reason why Google has been so successful on deploying the neural network technologies to over 60 production projects. And we just announced the availability of the exact same technology for the external developers, which is called Cloud Machine Learning, or CloudML. That is a TensorFlow-based, fully managed distributed training environment. So you can use tens of CPUs and GPUs inside Google Cloud to train your TensorFlow model. It's now public beta, available for anyone. So please go to cloud.google.com/ml to start trying out the technology. And I'd like to show the last demonstration, which is the AugNet. AugNet is the largest real-time car auction service in Japan. They have 30,000 used car dealers as members. But the problem is that each used car dealer have to upload tens of images of cars to use the auction service. It's tedious because the used car dealer have to classify what parts of the car of those images, and they have to identify the exact car model for each car images. The solution that AuchNet used is TensorFlow and CloudML. They were able to build their custom image classification model with TensorFlow and CloudML by using the 5,000 training images to classifying 500 car models. They have used Google's Inception version 3 model combined with the transfer learning technique. And by using CloudML, they were able to get the 6 times faster training speed. Let's take a look at the demonstration. So this is their website. And I'm going to choose some car images. Yes, we have many car images here. Maybe it would take some time, so because I'm using tethering, but maybe I can try. Now it's uploading the old images. It should take some time because I'm using mobile tethering. Now it started the classification of each part of the car. This is the real console you will be getting from TensorFlow. Looks like it's finishing. You got the result. So the TensorFlow model thinks the images must be in 2012 Toyota Land Cruiser with the exact car model, and you can also estimate the pricing range. And you can it can also classify the part of the car of each image, like a front, rear, right, left, tire, or dashboard, steering wheel, gauge. And it can also classify whether it's a front sheet or rear sheet. I don't know how it can classify those two. So that was the how CloudML has been used by Japanese customers. So as a wrap up, this is a summary of the technologies and products I've mentioned. There are two kinds of products. One is the ML APIs, which doesn't require any machine learning expertise. You can just send your image or audio or languages, natural languages, to the API. So you'll be getting the result in a few seconds. The other product is based on the TensorFlow, which is the open source based product. And by uploading TensorFlow model on the cloud, you can accelerate your training times 10 times or 100 times faster. So that was my talk. Thank you so much.